सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शांति शांति समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्म विद्वरम् ओम श्री चिन्मय सद्गुरवे नमः। योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तम प्रवरं मुनीनां पातंजलि प्राजलिना नतोस्मि। हरि ओम। वी आर इन द थर्ड पाद विभूति पाद ऑफ पातंजलि योग सूत्र। We have studied Ashtanga Yoga, the eight steps towards total integration. The first five are the Bahyaranga or the preparatory steps, and the last three are integrating steps or antaranga sadhana. One way of looking at Ashtanga Yoga is to see the structural steps slowly moving forward towards total integration or samadhi, starting from yama niyama, asana, pratyahara, and then moving on to dharana dhyana samadhi as the final steps. Now, if we look at the functionality of the mind, what happens exactly in the mind, in the chitta, we can enumerate the changes in chitta in a little different form. One is the anatomical structure of Ashtanga Yoga, the structural steps. You do this first, then you go to that, then you go to that. That is the way of structurally studying the Yoga Sutra. Functionally, if we study, then we focus more on the parinama, the effect that the yogi's chitta gets as he moves from the normal interactions with the world. Now he is moving upwards with newer vistas of experience. Mind well, he is still in the chitta. The yogi's chitta is still existing. Yogi's vrittis are still existing. The only difference is the qualitative aspect of the vritti has changed. So far, the chitta was engaged in variety of objects outside in the universe, enjoying or taking bhog, upabhog through the indriyas of the objects. Now he has withdrawn from that experience. What is the experience of interacting with the objects? We all know. There is no need to elaborate that. Me, my wife, my car. Feeling good, feeling bad, having sweet, not having bitter things, very pungent, beautiful sight, unbeautiful, ugly sight. These are all externalities of chitta when it associates with the object outside. So this is one experience. That is why this is called a loka. Loka means experiential state or experiential world. So our current experiential world, anubhavatmaka vishwa, is when we interact with the surroundings or the world, which we are well aware of. What we are not aware of is when I stop interacting with the objects of the universe and I start focusing on my own chitta, with the help of Patanjali Yoga Sutra's Ashtanga Yoga, then I still get experiences. Those experiences are different than the experience so far I was getting. So there is a loka again, but a higher loka or a different experience. The yogi who is adept in meditation again and again tries to go into this new state of mind, new experience, because he finds it to be far more beneficial, far more full of enthusiasm, far more happier state than the state of interacting with the world. And if you are not able to go higher up, then we are pulled back into the interaction with the world. Now the question is, why is it that I am not able to meditate? I want to experience what the yogi is experiencing. I've been told by Gurudeva that you meditate. There is a book also by Gurudeva on meditation when he was, I think, conducting the meditation exercises in Singapore. He has written a beautiful book. But even after reading the book 10 times, the meditation doesn't happen. What happens when we meditate? We are constantly pulled back into the world. Why so? Because my tendency to get into the world has been there for many births. I've been always looking outwards through the indriyas towards the objects. And I am repeating it every day, every moment. If we look at our own life, all we do from morning till evening is likes and dislikes. I like it, so I do it. I try to do it because I want to enjoy it. Then again, I change from that to something which I do and I dislike it. Then I am under compulsion to do it, so I go to the job. We do concentrate in our job, isn't it? Otherwise, the results won't come. We concentrate in our studies, isn't it? Otherwise, how did we pass the examination? Then why this is not meditation? Ask a question. Very pertinent question. To understand any intricacy of any grantha, I have to concentrate and then I understand. So why this is not meditation? A soldier, when he's completely involved in the war, he does a humongous feat of bravery. Why it is not meditation? The reason is all these so-called concentration exercises done by us in our daily life are done out of compulsion. I go to the office, concentrate on my work and finalize the balance sheet. So a work is produced out of my sheer concentration. But it is not meditation. It is compulsive concentration. The situational compulsion makes you to concentrate, leads you to concentrate. All of a sudden, a running car is coming towards you. You run. But you are not an athlete who is running. You're running for the life. compulsive running. Now, if the accident, if the car is not coming with that much of speed, now you will not run. People work in jails. That's because the jailer is there to see that you work. So this is not the work. In other words, all of these efforts of vyavaharik ekagrata, dhyana, is not dhyana, it is rajasic meditation. Rajasic meditation is out of compulsion, desire. Some vikshepa leads to meditation for the sake of result of the action. That is not meditation. So first, that should be cleared from the mind. Now comes the question, I have nothing to gain in meditation. Ask a person, what are you going to get if you meditate? Ask anybody, do you meditate? Yes. What are you going to get after meditation? From 7 to 8, I am going to meditate. And then you will get what? There is no answer. No, Gurudeva has told that everybody should meditate. All right, but for what? What do you expect in meditation? What is that you intend to achieve in meditation? And that is why, since it is an unknown territory, even theoretically, we are not aware of what precisely we want in meditation. We know the outer aspect, closing the eyes and sitting at one place is what all that is required for meditation. Other than this, we do not know anything about the meditation. Maximum, we will say that I'm trying to focus on an object. And still further, I would say I'm trying to focus on the murti of Bhagavan Sri Ram or Vishnu Narayana. Then what? We are not clear. To understand precisely what is expected during meditation, we must know what are the things that are happening in the chitta? Because when you meditate, your chitta is meditating. So we must, and I am not chitta. Mind well, chitta is an instrument. If I am not chitta, in fact, that is what gives me an ability to observe the chitta. How can I observe myself unless I am different than what I am observing? So chitta, the substratum, the bhumi in which the changes are happening, if I know precisely what changes I am expected to observe, then only I'll be able to do meditation properly. The crux of the thing is my mind or chitta is always with me. Everyone has chitta. And where is it in regular time? Any time if I see, where is my chitta? Where is it? It is associated with an object or the vichara. I open my eyes and the chitta goes towards a particular thought. There is a constant association of chitta with the object, may it be in the form of thought or may it be in the form of a physical object, that is immaterial. It is constantly going outward. Why outward? Because I presume all objects are outside. See, the very concept outside inside is an aberration. The biggest tragedy of life is to think that I am here and everything is outside. This is the fallacy that we are trying to remove through yoga. Me and object. Come what may, however scriptures I may read, however I may listen to Gurudeva, I am convinced in my mind that I am not Pradeepji. Not only that, I cannot be Pradeepji. Look at us. Ask a question. I cannot be Rajanji, I cannot be Vasishthaji, because Vasishthaji is a different person. How can I be a Meenakshi? Well, she is a woman, she is a different person, she is a different surname. It is so ingrained in my mind that the idea of thinking that there is no difference between me and object and we are same even does not arise in our mind in spite of studying all the scriptures. And the yoga says that the only thing that you are supposed to do in yoga is to completely understand that all that you feel as they and me is not at all they and me, but one thing. Yoga is a yuja, unison, unison of everything that is there. And it's not unison by theoretical standards, by actual anubhuti, that there is no difference between me and anything else. There is no me at all. Why talk of difference? But when it comes to actual practice of meditation, what is happening? Constantly my mind is going outwards towards the different vicharas or the objects. So that means, if we look at chitta, because chitta is the only thing that we are concerned in yoga shastra. Everything else is immaterial. Chitta, chitta, and chitta. You have to work only on mind. Working on mind is yoga. If at all anything else is done, it is to help the working on mind. No, I must be sitting in one posture for a long time, sthira sukhasanam. For what? So that I can work on the mind. I want to breathe properly and do pranayama. For what? To work on the mind. I don't want to get involved into these outward objects. I want to practice pratyahara. For what? So that I can work on chitta. I want to follow ahimsa. Why? So that I can work on chitta. All these are auxiliary functions so that we are able to focus on chitta. Now, when we are going to work on chitta, it is decided that the final bastion where everything is going to happen is chitta. All right, antakkarana or chitta. Now, when we are going to work on chitta, Patanjali Maharaj says, this chitta has three parinamas. Parinama is effect. Parinama is effect. What is the effect on chitta? Chitta per se, as a substratum, is in a state where it will change into something. The change in chitta is called vritti. When there is no change happening in the chitta, there is nothing wrong. Everything is fine. That's precisely how the cosmos is. That's precisely how the Lord wanted it. But the chitta is never in the form where it is not changing. A change in chitta is vritti. Vrittis are directed away from chitta. So chitta modifies. Modify, parinam, vikar, parinam, chitta modifies into many things. Now, what are the modifications of chitta? Chitta looks at an object and says that, oh, that is an object. Now, what happened? That object, which is nothing else but me, there is no difference between the object and me, but I feel now that is an object and I am an observer. This is a change brought about by the chitta. So, the world that we see outside is not in the form or in the state in which we see it. Little bit stretch the imagination. I see a tree, a object, a moving cat, a dog, horse, a lady, a water, air. I see that, agreed. But it is not that. Now, anybody would say that, how stupid of you. I can clearly see a dog there and you say it is not. That is what we are talking about. My perception of dog as a dog is nothing else but the parinama of my chitta. Then you will ask me a question. If that dog is not a dog, then that other person also called it a dog. We all know that it is a dog. How can you say that it is not a dog? Sir, a mistake committed by millions of people doesn't make it right. You are deluded in calling it dog. Others are also deluded in calling it a dog. No, but with calling it a dog, our vyavahar is happening, no? I can shoo the dog. The dog tends to bite and you say, and then it bleeds also and you see it is all false. How do you reconcile this? The reconciliation of this is that dog which is perceived as a dog has come from where? Has come from Pancha Mahabhuta. You have come from where? Pancha Mahabhuta. When Pancha Mahabhuta looks at Pancha Mahabhuta, can there be two Pancha Mahabhutas? Pancha Mahabhuta has transformed into a shape. Agreed. We are not denying that fact. The necklace and the bangles are different in the form of shape. But can we deny that it is gold? So if I am a goldsmith, I will look at it as gold while selling. A goldsmith is not concerned with what is that. As long as you buy it, he's happy because gold is sold. But a customer, a lady would look at, oh, what a fine bangle this is. But this is, you know, different than that necklace is still more beautiful. Customer or the lady's point of view is different than the goldsmith's point of view. What happened, sir? Why the same gold is seen by two different people in two different manners? The difference lies in the chitta. The way chitta responded to the things outside decides what you see outside or what you perceive outside. Everyone in the Kali Mandir saw a cat. The Vesper services were on. The puja, the aarti was going on. The people had assembled and they saw right in the sanctum sanctorum near Kali Ma's statue in the Murti, there is a cat there. So everybody saw a cat. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa looked at the cat and said, Ma, you have come in the form of cat today. Okay, you want to eat from my hand? And he fed the cat the prasad of Kali Ma meant for Kali Mata. Everybody felt, what a insult to the deity. This man is feeding the cat. Now, who was right and who was wrong? All the devotees who assembled were right in perception, or Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was right in perception? Simply because everyone saw a cat doesn't make it a cat. One person also knows the art of seeing, he saw it as Kali Mata. And now this we heard as a story related to Paramahamsa. Now we are students of Yoga Shastra. We want to find the reason behind that kind of seeing of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. In order to know that, we must know what is this so-called chitta and its business of perception. So for that, Patanjali Maharaj, being the great sutrakarta he is, he tells that forget about the varieties of experiences that one gets. If you have to write the number of experience you get in individual life, there are billions and multiple individuals will be billion into billion. But Patanjali Maharaj says, let's forget about it. All he says is the only changes that can happen in chitta are of three types. Focus on those three types and you will understand what happens in antakarana or chitta when it perceives something. The first parinama. Now he says, he calls these three changes as parinama. Remember, very important criteria in Sankhya philosophy is, we have seen evolution of Sankhyas starting from Prakriti or Pradhana, then Mahat, then Ahankara, then we come down to Tanmatras, then Panchama Bhutas, then Chitta. We have seen the evolutionary theory of Sankhya in detail. We have seen it. Everything is starting from Prakriti. And then everything else is evolute of Prakriti. Prakriti has transformed down the line into different things. But these transformations are of two types. When you say Prakriti, then there is no precursor to that. That means there is no cause. Prakriti is the cause. Prakriti is, what is the cause of Prakriti? There is no cause. So Prakriti is, that is why the word Prakriti itself means cause. From the Prakriti, Mahat Tattva was formed. Now, what is the cause of Mahat? Prakriti. That means Mahat is change from Prakriti into Mahat. Prakriti changes into Mahat. From Prakriti comes Mahat. So, change can happen in two ways. One is Parinama and one is Tattvantara. Tattvantara means Prakriti is a principle. Mahat is also principle. Buddhi or Mahat is also principle. Mahat comes from the Prakriti. So Mahat has a cause. But Mahat itself can become cause of something, which is Ahankar. So that means a thing can be either a cause or cause and effect or only effect. All this has bearing on understanding the sutras that is going to now be discussed. So we need to understand the fundamental first. A thing can be a cause or cause and effect, effect of something and cause of something. And it can be only effect. So from where my ahankar has come? From the Mahat. And what is the effect of this ahankara? Panchamahabhutas. Same thing can act as cause and same thing can be effect of something. At the top is Prakriti. There is no cause of Prakriti. Prakriti can only give rise to effect. That's why it is called Prakriti. Down the line in Prakriti, we have what is called as cause and effect, Prakriti Vikriti. Effect is Vikriti. And when we come down to Pancha Mahabhutas, what after Pancha Mahabhutas? Look, in Sankhya Tattva Jnana, we start from Prakriti, but we end at Pancha Mahabhuta. Why we end at Pancha Mahabhuta? Why not further transformation? All further transformation is only effect. Only effect, Vikruti, Vikar. That is why we call it Shad Vikar or whatever Vikaras. Vikar means only changes. Changing and changing and changing. That change cannot act as a cause. Like our own body made up of Panchamahabhuta. Okay, from this body, now what will be created? Something will be created. that creation will also be panchamahabhuta. Why? Body by itself will not create a new thing. It will carry forward what it is made up of. When you carry forward the same constituent and just undergo a change. Example, a small child is panchamahabhuta, turns into a young man. What happened? There is a change that happened. Vikar happened. He was a small child, now he is a young adult. So change happened. Badal. It has changed. Avasthantara has happened. Avastha changed. Shaishava avastha to tarunya avastha. Agreed. But what has it changed? Only the change, only the effect has transformed. No new thing has formed. This is parinam. This is a very important bearing in Yoga Shastra. That means we can make a general statement that everything in this world is from Panchamahabhuta. Tanmatra and Panchamahabhutas are the one that have created everything. Whether it is me, my mind also is made up of, the tree and the mind are made up of same thing. See, this statement may sound very ridiculous, but it is not. Expression or the state could be different things. That's a different thing. A tree cannot speak, a dog can bark, I will speak. That's fine. That is functionality. What is important is what it is made up of, what I am made up of, that itself means everything that we see in the world is made up of the same thing. Now, if the bracelet is made up of gold, the earring is made up of gold, the necklace is made up of gold, then if I take any one of them and melt it to know what is the metal in this, the answer will be gold. Now, there is no need to melt every ornament. All of them are made up of gold. I can come to that conclusion. Also, if I can melt the bracelet, I know the art of melting the bracelet. I also would know the art of melting the necklace. Why this is important is, my mind being panchamahabhutatmaka, my indriyas being panchamahabhutatmaka or tanmatratmaka, if I'm able to control my mind, it would mean I can control panchamahabhutas. And since all the world is made up of panchamahabhutas, I'll be able to control the world. The implication lies here. I work on my mind. When I'm working on my mind, I'm also working on the whole world, because the whole world constituently is same as my mind. If I'm able to meditate and concentrate ekagrata on my mind, I can use the same ekagrata on any object in the world, including the human being. What is the effect of this concentration or ekagrata or sanyama as we studied? Dharana, dhyana, samadhi together is called sanyama. So what you do sanyama on any object or sanyama on your mind. When you do sanyama, what happens? The only thing that happens is sanyama leads to the opening of real nature of the substance. This is an handkerchief. Now I'm looking at handkerchief. What comes to my mind? Oh, handkerchief, its utility. It is made up of cotton. It has got fiber. There is a thing called cotton. All right. Our knowledge does not extend beyond that. I do not know the true nature of the handkerchief. What is the true nature of the handkerchief? Panchamahabhutatmaka. But I don't see akash, jala, vayu, nothing. My scriptures tell me that. But I so distinctly call this as handkerchief that my mind even doesn't think that it is panchamahabhutatmak. I look at the utility part, my daily routine part, and I say, it's white in color. Now, if it is said that, sir, it has no color, you will say that, are you mad? This is white in color. How can you say it has no color? if I go into the deeper aspect of an object, the deeper aspect of the handkerchief, I will realize that, oh, it is not a handkerchief. It is made up of only the cotton fibers. Now, where is my knowledge? My knowledge has penetrated into the deeper aspect of the object. Now, how do I come to know that it is made up of fibers? I saw when this is made. That is how I came to know that we call it handkerchief, but it is nothing else but crisscross fibers of cotton yarn. Oh, oh, oh. So now the knowledge has reached to the level of cotton yarn. Again, further, I go deeper and I realize that, oh, the cotton yarn, you know what it is? It is spinned out of a cotton. So the cotton ball that you see on the tree is the origin cause of this effect. See, the knowledge has extended further to cotton. That is where most probably it ends also. Now comes the question, that cotton which came on the crop had green leaves, green stem, it went into the red soil, received water every day. How did it become white in color and came as a cotton bud? The leaf does not get stretched into a fiber, but the cotton gets stretched into a fiber. We don't make cotton from the stem of cotton tree, but from this cotton ball. That means same tree is giving different characters to different parts of its body. And then comes the question, this cotton was actually put into the soil in the form of a seed. Now that seed had no cotton bud at all, but it grew into a tree and gave the cotton bud. That means the cotton bud and the seed must be related. That means the cotton bud appearance must be present in the seed in the dormant form. See now how the knowledge is going further deeper. And mind well, we are still at a gross level. Now, if I really intend to go further deeper, I will try to study the seed to know which tissue gets converted into this particular cotton ball. Fine. Now I'm undergoing the microscopic examination. Further down I go, I realize that that particular substance called cambium or whatever in that plant is nothing else but atomic particles. They are all molecules. Now I go further deeper into it. I see, no. All these molecules are made up of only atoms. Actually, you call it cotton, cotton seed, cotton ball, this handkerchief. No, sir. Everything is, ask any physicist, he will say that, oh, it's all a game of atoms everywhere. If they're all made up of atoms, why they look different? He will say, don't ask this question. Atoms are arranged in a different manner. That's why you see them. Otherwise, it is atom only. Ask a chemical scientist, chemistry proficient person, he will say that what is there in the body? Burn it. It is all carbon. For him, this body is carbon. Then physicist will jump and say that, no, sir, it is not even carbon. What is carbon? It is C4. It has valency of 4, but it basically has atoms and molecules only, and molecules are made up of atoms. Call a quantum physicist, he will say, no, forget about this atom. Atom is too big a thing. All subatomic particles, ultra small. The quantum mechanics person will say that, actually, let me tell you, even those subatomic particles also, I can't say with surety because they keep moving at such a rapid speed that I can't say what it is exactly made up of. I can tell you that it is uncertain. Schrodinger's principle of uncertainty, Heisenberg's principle of uncertainty. The theory of uncertainty is the soul of quantum mechanics. Nothing is certain, sir. What does that mean? This all we saw from the science angle. Now we will see from Patanjali Yoga Sutra's angle. And for that, Patanjali Maharaj wants us first to start from chitta, And that chitta substance, which is the only substance of concern in our body, rest everything is paraphernalia. The ears, the indriyas, this, all the secondary. Don't focus on them at all. We have to look at the owner. Rest all are servants. They will not give us much information. The owner knows the secret. So the chitta is the one which is holding the secret. Our whole problem, our salvation, our entanglement, our stupidity, our cleverness, everything emanates in this substance called chitta. Now this chitta has an avastha where nothing is happening in the chitta. When nothing is happening in the chitta, then what happens, sir? The answer is nothing happens, sir. Sir, nothing happens means what happens? No, nothing happens means nothing happens. Very difficult to understand. There is a chitta where nothing is happening. But I'm used to something happening always. See, every one of us want to meditate and want to go into thoughtless condition. It sounds very nice. But just try to imagine. When you are thoughtless, what you will be? We can't even imagine. What do you mean by thoughtless? I am so much used to the thoughts. A constantly jumping monkey, if you tell him, sit at one place, he will say, what is it, sit at one place? I don't know what this man is talking. You're supposed to go here and there. How can you sit at, what is sitting at one place? Similarly, we cannot understand a chitta where there is no vritti is happening. And Patanjali Maharaj says, that is your goal. Yoga chitta vritti nirodha. Vritti nirodha means you will be at a level of chitta where chitta is virtually not existing. Because chitta's existence is only proved by presence of vritti. If there is no vritti, there cannot be chitta. If there are no waves, there is no ocean. Because it is the waves that comprise the ocean. No, I want to take out the water from the ocean and I want to see how the ocean looks like. So, no possible, sir. Water itself makes the ocean. Now, for that vritti removal or that particular state, that goal, when that goal is not achieved, when the chitta is not without vritti, then what it is? Whenever there are vrittis in the chitta, it can have only three parinamas. And parinama means transformation, modification, not new birth, only modification. Same clay becoming a pot. Clay to pot. There is a cause-effect relation, but it is an effect. Pot is not a cause. Pot is an effect. So chitta can have three parinamas. First, it's called nirodha parinama. What is nirodha parinama? When we think or when we are working in this world, what does our chitta do? It goes with one thought, comes back, goes to another thought, comes back, goes to the third thought, sometimes stays at the thought and goes into the further details of that thought. Let us take an example. It's a stupid example, but it is a good example. In fact, in Patanjali Yoga Sutra's Bhashya, repetitively these examples of the type which I am giving are taken. When you think of a lady, kamotsuka person, the one who has kama vasana is thinking of a lady. Now what has happened? Chitta has gone towards a lady. Okay, fine. Now is his mind chitta going to some other thing? No, he's thinking of the lady. So now everything else is kind of a silent. But as far as the lady is concerned, is it only with the lady? No. Again, pertaining to the lady, multiplicity of thoughts. Oh, this is beautiful to look at. Oh, she's this, she's that, she's this, she's, and especially and in the past and in the future, do you know, and if I can see so many varieties coming about one object. So that means every time the mind will go out to a object, then come back and go to another object, or in the same object, come back and again go into the same object. That means you move from the face of the lady to some other aspect of the lady. What has happened? Object has apparently remained one, but you have already moved between two points. Multiple objects or multiple points in one object. Right now, I'm thinking about how to make more money on the stock market. What has happened? Now I'm not thinking about the car, about the wife, about the job. I'm thinking only about stock market. But in stock market now, I'm thinking about which share, when, how much, what quantity, short term, long term. What happened? For the same object, multiplicity. This is the tendency of the mind which is not trained. So every time the mind flits from one object to another object or one aspect of the object to the another aspect of the object. What Patanjali Maharaj is trying to say is, even in the Vyavahara, you do not stay at one point for a longer time. This is Vikshepa. Constantly flitting from one to another. And this constant flitting is Rajoguna. Rajoguna makes us go from point to point at a very fast pace. Sometimes to the extent we say to ourselves that, you know, today my brain is not working because it's been quite taxed since morning. You know, so many things I'm thinking. We do that. When this happens, this is what is called vitthana. Vitthana, running towards an object. Vitthana. Going outwards constantly. Now, when you are not going out, suppose now I am on object A, from there my mind comes back and goes to object B. From object A, when it comes back and then it goes to object B, there is a time when it is neither on A nor on B. That is the point which is called Nirodha. How long is that point? Infinitesimally small. We even don't realize it. Every one of us is having Nirodha, but we don't realize it. For a very small period, it stays. That means there are two aspects in the chitta. One, you are employing your chitta on an object and no other thing. Second is, your chitta is moving constantly from one aspect to the other aspect of the object or from object to object. And the third is, you are neither focusing on an object nor flitting between the object. That means you are not doing anything. Not doing anything for a very microscopically small point is Nirodha, because that is the point there is no vritti in the mind. This is called Nirodha Parinama. We also get a glimpse of these things When we look at a small child playing somewhere, our mind or chitta focuses on that child for a little longer time, and frankly ask a question to yourself. What are you focusing on that child when you look at the child? You are not focusing on any aspect of the child. You are focusing only on child. Child is a abstract entity. You're just looking at the face of the child. You're not looking at his nose. And no, that means there is no dissipation on the aspect of the object also. So the concentration there remains for a little longer time. You feel happy about it. The happiness that we get by looking at a small child playing is out of sheer concentration or meditation happening for a little longer period than normally that it is happening. It happens at a time when we eat our favorite dish for a very small point of time. Generally, we use the word "ah" to express the feeling, but it's only for a moment. What it means is Nirodha Parinama is a Parinama of Sattvika Vritti, while the flitting Parinama, going from different objects, one to other object or different aspect of the object, is Rajasika Vritti. So this is called Nirodha Parinama. Now, constantly we are struggling between Vyutthana, going from here to there, Nirodha, not going anywhere. Not going anywhere, going everywhere. Not going anywhere, going everywhere. Vyutthana Nirodha, Vyutthana Nirodha. So this is the first Parinama of Chitta. Patanjali Maharaj says, I am trying to tell you three states of mind or Chitta, out of which first is Nirodha Parinama and Vyutthana Parinama. Vyutthana you already know because every day it is happening. Nirodha, you don't realize but it is happening with you, but for a very small period. Why is he saying this? Because he says, your Vyutthana is 99.99999 and your Nirodha is 0.00000001%. Yoga is making Nirodha 100%, Vyutthana zero. The target is that. When you try to do this, when you really, really want to change your mind, chitta, from Vyutthana to Nirodha, then what do? You start doing exercises to increase the Nirodha Parinama period and reduce the Vyutthana period. For that, when you start doing it, first thing you do is, my problem is, what is the worst problem? Worst problem is going from object to object. In Hindi, it is called dar dar bhatakna. That's a very bad problem. So Patanjali Maharaj says, okay, first do one thing. Stop this flitting into different objects. Get yourself on one object. This is sarvarthata. Sarvartha, this object, that object, sarvarthata. From there you come to ekarthata or ekagrata. How do I do that, Patanjali Maharaj? He says, take any object of your choice. Now what you do? Nothing. Let your chitta do what it was doing only on that object. Now what is happening? Now I'm not thinking of a car, a woman, a child, a tree, a dog. No, I'm only thinking about one thing. That is a lady. Why not? I can use that as an object of meditation. Patanjali Maharaj cautions us. What is the caution? Look, if you take an object where you already have established a relationship, then your purva samskara will always lead to, again, dispersion of disintegration of concentration. Then what do? Take an object where you are not having much impressions with. And which is the object where you don't have much impression with, not much samskara with? That which you have not experienced. All right. Let me take a murti of Bhagavan Shri Ram. Why? I have never experienced Bhagavan Shri Ram. So why should I feel good or bad about it? Yes, everybody says he's a Bhagavan, Bhagavan. So I have a reverence. My only impression about that thing is reverence. Patanjali Maharaj says that is very good, that is allowed. Other than reverence, if any upabhogatmak vritti is there, then the question comes, Patanjali Maharaj, after concentrating, if I develop bhogatmak vritti with Bhagavan Shri Ram, then he says that is allowed. Because moment I take Bhagavan Shri Ram, and if my concentration goes to a higher level, I might actually feel and get anubhuti of serving live Shri Ram in the manapatal of mine, where actually I am pressing the legs of Shri Ram. That can happen. And that will be very addictive, because that experience will be very nice. Patanjali Maharaj says that is absolutely allowed. In fact, that is what is expected. Because you have already transcended what I want you to transcend. So take an object where you have not much relationship in terms of bhoga samskar. Bhoga samskar gives rise to lots and lots of different impressions in the mind. Just take a live example. Take a food which we like most. See, moment I say Shrikhandam, immediately, where is it? When can I get it? Long time I have not made it. Let us make it. Especially if you eat it with puri, and you know, and basundi is not that superior compared to Shrikhandam, but kheer is, see what happened? Purva bhoga samskara. So nirodha parinam is what he wants you to do. But when you take an object, then what happens? Now where the thoughts are going? Now where the chitta is going? Now chitta is not going outside, but it is constantly going on that object. Now when it goes on that object, what happens? While thinking of Bhagavan Shri Ram as an object, I am thinking of only Bhagavan Shri Ram, Shri Ram, Shri Ram, Shri Ram. Suddenly the mind goes outside. But again, Shri Ram, again goes outside. Now what is happening? Now the fight is between the object of meditation and leaving the object of meditation. What was the flight earlier? Earlier the fight was between this object, that object, that object, that object, multiplicity of the object or multiplicity of aspect of the object. Now the fight is Shri Ram, non-Shri Ram, Shri Ram, non-Shri Ram. This is ekagrata on Shri Ram, non-ekagrata on the Shri Ram. Ekagrata on the Shri Ram, non-ekagrata on the Shri Ram. This is the second battle. This ekagrata on the Shri Ram and non-ekagrata, kshaya udaya chittasya sarvartha ekagrata yoho parinama samadhi parinam. This is the second parinam called samadhi parinam. One is nirodha parinam. Second is samadhi parinam. What is the difference between the two? Nirodha parinam is all the world objects and everything and coming back from there. What is samadhi parinam? One object, again going away from one object. Object going away from samadhi parinam. Taila dharavat. Now what happens? Here also Patanjali Maharaj says practice, keep practicing. Then what will happen? Coming out of the object will become less and less. Going into the object will become more and more. More you go into the object, then what happens? Samadhi parinam happens. And then when the chitta is going towards an object in a regular fashion for a very long period of time, then the third change happens, which is very difficult to attain, but that is the change everybody is looking as a yogi, that is called ekagrata parinam. Now, what is ekagrata parinam? Not only that you are focusing on one object, you are becoming an object. Tulya pratyaya chitta. Tasya ekagrata parinam. Tulya pratyaya means like me. What do I feel about myself? I feel about the object. So far, I was calling Rama, Rama, Shri Rama, Shri Rama, Shri Rama, fully knowing that I am the meditator and Shri Ram is in that particular murti. Now, Tulya Pratyaya, the way I experience myself, I experience Shri Ram. When can I experience Shri Ram? When I become Shri Ram. If I become Shri Ram, then what about me? I cannot be existing. Prema gali ati sakari tame do na samai. Kabir Maharaj says, the lane of prema is so narrow, two people cannot be adjusted. So when you do the object concentration and take it to the ekagrata level, then you realize the tulya pratyaya, swatulya pratyaya in the object, which is called ekagrata parinama. So the object, the chitta can be only in one of these three. Vyutthana nirodha parinam, samadhi parinam, and ekagrata parinam. Samadhi parinam and ekagrata parinam, we have not at all experienced. We are miles away from it. Vyutthana, every day we are, and nirodha, very little of it every day, which we call happiness and enjoyment, is that little nirodha parinam. By forcefully in the beginning, with a clear understanding that my vyutthana I'm going to reduce, nirodha I'm going to increase. Once nirodha is increased, then you are entitled to get into the second stage of samadhi parinam. And a continuous practice of samadhi leads to ekagrata parinama. And that is the process by which what is happening is you are changing the chitta as far as parinamas are concerned. Mind well, the chitta is still existing. That is why this is sampradnyat samadhi. Chitta, because this is only the modification of chitta from the most turbulent to the most focused. But turbulent or focused, it's chitta only. That means chitta is still existing. Vritti is still existing. Yes, the vritti had changed in its form. It was multiple, multiplicity, moving and flitting and all. Now it has become ekam agre asit. Only one object and one thing. What happens while this particular transformation? Patanjali Maharaj says, whenever you do Vyutthana to Nirodha, Nirodha to Samadhi, Samadhi to Ekagrata, you get new experiences, new vrittis. That new vritti or experience is much enjoyable and higher. Because it is sattvic in nature, sattvikta has anandam as its essential dharma. So you start feeling happy. Unless you have sattvikata, you will not have nirodha parinam and samadhi and ekagrata parinam. Because of sattvikata, anandam will come. And once the first level of nirodha is achieved and you start testing the happiness, then you will feel, now there is nothing in this world. Why? Because you start getting more happiness here than in the world. That is the time meditation gets into the full swing. Now the person is not interested in samsara. Now he says, when can I get time? I don't want all this. I want to go to Himalayas. I want to be in solitude. Solitude and do what? No, sir. I just want to work on my mind, get into that nirodha parinam, samadhi parinam, and stay basking in that glory of happiness that I get. Patanjali Maharaj says, getting stuck in that happiness, my son, is not the goal. But yes, through this ekagrata, you shall be going forward. Now the question is, if I'm working on my mind for all these things, how it will give me the control of the whole world? You become Swami of all the three worlds. Triloka Swami, you become. How? That is the subject of discussion of the next sutra. Bhutendriyashu that's going to come. Dharma lakshana avastha. Nirodha parinam, samadhi parinam, ekagrata parinam of the mind is precisely the same when it comes to any object in the world. There it is called dharma lakshana avastha. Here it is called nirodha samadhi ekagrata. How the mind and the object is related in terms of these three avasthas, once we understand that, then we will understand the secret that all objects, the mind is one of the object, remember. All, everything is made up of prakriti or the panchamahabhuta, so is the mind. So if we know the mind completely through these three parinamas, you will know the objects completely. So when you, so far you are concentrating on your mind because you want to go to ekagrata. Once you master this art, remove the mind, take any object and you will realize the real nature of the object. The real nature of the object is always eluding us. The real nature of the object is the same everywhere. Sarveshu, sarva bhuteshu, ekatvam anupashyati. That so lofty idea of Upanishada comes into the picture only when we dissect this. So we shall be seeing in the next session what we saw of the mind, we will see of the object, and then we will see how the both are same. Once that is understood, then the rest of the adhyaya is all about the mastery of the world, the siddhis. Hari Om. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harih Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harih Om.
Some questions.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Sanjay Rajendra here. Now, as the students of Vedanta, most of the time with the result of these studies and classes, what happens to my mind is that while doing all these household chores and works, many things here at home, the mind is dwelling only on God, either Ram or Krishna or Devi. These murtis are one by one coming. You know, when I see a temple of Devi temple, then Devi, or if it is a Krishna temple, then Krishna. Similarly, if it is a Rama temple, Rama. And everywhere, every time this is the thought in the mind. What is this level?
Hari Om. The very fact that mind or the chitta is now getting habituated to certain deities, certain gods, it means that the process of integration has started. Now the vyutthana which is happening is now getting reduced, and the vyutthanata now is coming towards ekartata. Earlier it was sarvartata. One object, then another object, one work, another work, one thought, another thought. Now the work is happening on a superficial level, but the attention, the chitta, the mind is again and again reverting back. The bird is flying outside but coming back home. Now coming back home is happening quite often. That means the chitta is getting habituated to one object. This is an attempt from sarvarthata to ekarthata. In other words, it is a practice of nirodha. Now a complete nirodha is yet to be achieved, but vyutthana is getting restricted. The child who was running always away from the home is now coming closer to the, it is yet to enter the home. but it is coming closer to the home. That is the meaning of this. That is the reason why we are constantly told to be in satsanga, temple, nama, japa, puja, prasadam, all these thoughts. See, when you are doing aarti, you are many times, we are not there in the aarti. We are physically doing it. But again and again, the mind says, oh, I have to do aarti. There is a Bhagavan standing here. I have to light the lamp. These thoughts bring, the vyutthanata is reduced. It is so beautifully ingrained into the daily activities in Hindu family. The whole idea is to reduce the vyutthana, going towards object and bringing towards, at least in the 1 hour of the puja that we do, for 1 minute at least, the mind come towards the God. And then when it gets habituated throughout the period, you do upavasam. Upavasam is for the physical part, forget about it. Upavasam is related to some God. We say Mahashivratri Upavasam, Ekadashi Upavasam, then Krishna Janmashtami Upavasam. So by that Upavasam, throughout the day we remind, oh, today is Datta Jayanti. Today is Krishna Janmashtami. So what is happening? You are always retraining your mind, chitta, to reduce the vyutthana and get more and more towards the ekarthata. So everybody through this is practicing yoga only. It may not have that name, but the process remains precisely what Patanjali Maharaj has said. So with what is happening with you is your vyutthana is going down, your nirodha is slowly is an ascendancy. This, when you take into a full-blown structure, it will help you to propel forward towards samadhi and ekagrata. Hari Om.
Hari Om.